Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I'm Dr. Aparna Vatve, faculty of Tata Institute of Social Sciences. This module talks about conservation of ecosystems and species in India. It is part of the paper Environment and Society. In this module, we will talk about some of the traditional practices of conservation in India. We will look at sacred natural sites and sacred species. In the end, we will look at how this helps in conservation. India has many cultures. Some of the communities in India have stayed here for thousands of years. They have developed their own practices of natural resource management. Most of the practices were for using nature, but there were some practices which ended up protecting nature. We are going to look at such practices which ended up protecting ecosystems or habitats. People always modified nature to benefit themselves. But in the whole landscape, they continued to maintain parts of nature as it was. Some of these practices can still be seen. Most have received a setback and we cannot see them anymore. Colonization, changing culture, demands of market economy are just some of the factors which are responsible for changing the traditional conservation practices. Such practices are seen all over the world. In India, we see them in all parts and all states. These practices make use of taboos. Killing a pregnant animal is not allowed. It is considered a taboo. It is a sin. Coastal fishermen do not go to fishing in the rainy season. This is season for breeding of fish. Harvesting fish at this time will endanger the future supply of fish. So this taboo helps in the breeding of fish. Very often, the connection with the taboos and the conservation is lost. It had changed over the time with culture. Conservation practices can be broadly divided into two groups. The first is sacred natural sites and the second is sacred species. These are not all of them. There are several traditional practices that cannot fit into any of these categories. But for the moment, we will focus on these two categories. Sacred natural sites are defined as areas of land or water having special spiritual significance to people and community. These are ancient protected areas. They harbor valuable biodiversity and protect key ecosystems. Indigenous groups had spiritual connections to some parts of the land. They are very different from the national parks which are created by the government. National parks are created by law, but the traditional conservation areas are maintained by customs and beliefs of local people. First of these practices is of maintaining sacred groves. Sacred groves are patches of forest. These are areas dedicated to a deity. They often form center of cultural and religious life of people in parts of the world. They are seen in Africa, Asia, Europe, and even in America. Kayas were the sacred forests seen in Kenya. The Mijikenda people of Kenya used to live in thick forest areas. Kayas were their villages. There were sacred objects buried in the kaya. People believed that maintaining the kaya was important for the well-being of the entire community. During the 19th century, the population increased and Mijikenda people had to move out of the kayas. But we still continue to see the kaya sacred groves in Kenya. In 1993, 2,000 hectares of forest was under kaya groves in Kenya. Indian sacred groves have been very well documented. In 1897, a German silviculturist wrote about sacred groves in his travel reports. He had seen them in all parts of India. In 1920, William Logan wrote about groves in Malayali households. He wrote that in the larger houses, one part of the garden is maintained as a Sarpakau. Sarpakau are forests dedicated to the snake. All the plants in this grove, whether they are trees, shrubs or climbers, they are considered sacred. They cannot be cut, otherwise it will bring wrath of the deity. In 1921, Travancore had 12,000 sacred cows. Ayyappan groves of Kerala are still seen today. In the western ghats of Maharashtra, Devrais are sacred forest. They are known as Devrais or Devrahatis. Devrai actually means forest for the god. Some of them are very small, but some of them can be very large also. It was believed that a person cutting the tree or cutting even a leaf from the sacred grove will be punished by the deity. The villages also had their own punishments. Sacredness as well as the fear of the god helped to protect the sacred groves. The forest inside the sacred grove was much older than anything seen in the landscape. Devrais always had large trees, giant climbers, which were protected because of the sacredness. Many rare plants were seen in the grove. Outside the sacred grove, area was converted into farming. But even today, sacred grove remains as old forest patches. Similar practices are seen in Karnataka. Devara Kadus are sacred groves of the Kodagu district of Karnataka. In Chhattisgarh, sacred groves were locally known as Matagudi, Devgudi or Gaudevi. Sarna sacred groves are found in the Chota Nagpur region. Most of these groves are managed by the local community, but they might be owned by a group of families or a clan. Very often, sacred grove is a place for community rituals. It is a place for meeting of the entire village. The rituals that are practiced in the sacred groves are linked to the agricultural calendar. These rituals are meant to strengthen the links between nature and people. In India, sacred groves were protected by communities involved actively in the management of entire landscape. Colonial administration did not realize this. When all the forest was made into state property, even the sacred groves became government lands. Slowly, the taboo started breaking. Many sacred groves were destroyed in this process. Some sacred groves were converted into private land holdings. Some of the sacred groves were bought by the wood contractors and cut within a few days. Today, sacred groves can be seen only in the most remote parts of India. If the community institution is strong, groves are maintained in good shape. Sacred forests in Northeast India remain under community control. They are much better preserved than any other groves in India. Moflong village in Meghalaya has a large sacred grove. It is a place for conducting rituals by the community. In the Moflong sacred grove, community still continues to practice certain rituals which are to communicate with the ancestors and with the deity. They believe that it helps to protect them and their territory. The area is still regarded as sacred and it is very well preserved. Today, in some parts of the grove, tourists are allowed to visit. A small fee has to be paid to the village as a part of upkeep. The sacredness of the Moflong sacred grove is still maintained. Sanskritization of religion is another major threat to the sacred groves. Many groves had non-Brahmanical deities. A lot of groves had female goddesses. They were probably quite ancient deities. In some sacred groves, the folklore declared that the deity will be angered if they were covered by a roof. They were kept open to the elements. The forest itself was a temple. But today this had changed. In some cases, people have cut the sacred groves and built a temple in its place. The original deity is pushed to a corner of some sacred grove or it's lost. The place of the original deity is now taken by the mainstream Hindu gods and goddesses like Durga, Hanuman or Shiva. Reverence towards the forest is now replaced by worship at the temple. Sacred groves are remnants of old conservation tradition. They continue to protect rare trees and wilderness from destruction. Maharashtra has a sacred grove called Dhoop Rahat in Pune district. This grove is a forest protected around two rare dhoop trees. These trees are scientifically known as Canarium strictum trees. They exude an aromatic substance known as dhoop. This species is very rare in the dry forests of Maharashtra. They are not seen anywhere else in that area. Myristica swamps is a very special ecosystem seen in the southern India. Some sacred groves called Kan groves in Karnataka have myristica swamps. These sacred groves store water and release it very slowly as perennial water flows. Sacred groves often have perennial sources of water. They help in ecosystem recharge and provide water to the local communities. Even the smallest of the groves have a diversity of plants and birds and mammals. So far, we have seen examples of sacred forest habitats. But there are other natural habitats which are also called sacred. West Sikkim Himalaya has a sacred landscape known as Demojong. It starts from the Mount Kanchenjunga and goes down to the foothills of Himalaya. All through this landscape, we can see different types of forest and other habitats. Sikkimese Buddhists considered Padmasambhava as the supreme deity which has blessed this landscape. There are clearly defined institutional arrangements of what can be done and what cannot be done in this landscape. India also has examples of Sufi sacred groves. These are sacred groves protected around a pir. Many rivers, water bodies, ponds also are considered sacred. Ganga is a classic example of a sacred river. It is not only the river, but the entire landscape along the Ganga river that is considered sacred. Gangotri, Badrinath, Kedarnath, Rishikesh are all sacred areas. As a group, they represent a set of interconnected ecosystems, and the river is a link between them. Hill streams and ponds are given a special protection. They are homes of water deities. Fish are considered holy animals. They are avatars of Vishnu. In some areas, people have designated fish sanctuaries in parts of rivers on ponds near the temple. Fish sanctuaries are recently noted in Karnataka, Maharashtra, and Uttarakhand. New community conserved fish sanctuaries are also set up by local communities. Shrungeri Math was established around 1200 years ago on the banks of River Tunga. It has a fish sanctuary that protects endangered Sahyadri Mahasir fish. Chippalgude Fish Sanctuary is located on the banks of Tunga River. The Temple Trust protects 4 km long stretch of Tunga River. Killing fish in this area is a taboo. The temple has even built platforms for people to come and feed the fish. There are stories of what misfortune comes to you if you accidentally kill the fish. Large sacred sites are threatened with changes in the entire landscape. When outsiders come and settle in area, they bring their own culture and their values. Urbanization also changes culture. Tourism around sacred grove might also lead to destruction of the grove itself. Gupta Bhima is a source of origin of River Bhima in Maharashtra. Next to this source is a large sacred grove of Bhima Shankar. In this grove is an ancient temple, one of the famous 12 Jyotirlingas. People who come to this temple worship the deity, but at the same time, they throw a lot of garbage all around the forest. At the time of Mahashivratri, tons of garbage are present in the forest. Same is the case with Ganga. Ganga is a sacred river, but that has not stopped people from throwing garbage in it. There are industries which release effluent in the Ganga river system. Sometimes the sacredness remains as a myth or as a story. It is not translated into actual action of protection. Today, there is a movement to save Ganga from pollution. It is started by the government and many people have joined in it. So far, we have looked at how sacredness helps protect habitats. There is another tradition of considering certain species as sacred. Sacred species is a different conservation practice. These species might actually be used. They are planted in many places. Peepal, banyan, audumbar are some examples of sacred species. They are all having some medicinal value or other. Fig, ficus species are also known as fig species. They have many fruits which are important for the local animals and birds. Tulsi or Indian basil is another example of a sacred species. In the old homes, Tulsi Vrindavan or a small shrine to Tulsi was always present. Even today, even if you go to urban areas or you go to slum areas, you will find one single Tulsi plant in the garden. Sometimes the ecological significance of these practices cannot be easily judged. But it does lead to people worshipping nature. Peacock is the national bird of India. It is today protected by Wildlife Protection Act. But even in the past, people had a taboo on killing peacock. Peacock was considered a vehicle of Saraswati or Kartikeya. In ancient cultures of India, peacock is believed to be the symbol of Mother Earth. Peacock has always been protected. The law came much later. It is very common today to see, even in cities, peacock roaming about freely. If you visit gardens of Delhi or Ahmedabad, you will see people and peacocks moving around together. Tiger, leopard, turtles, black bucks, monkeys are just some examples of how species were considered sacred. They are all associated with some god or are considered vehicles of a god or goddess. This protected them from being killed on a large scale. Elephants raid crops in many areas of India. They are driven away by the people. But many people find it very difficult to kill the elephant because they consider it the god. Sacredness may not always lead to protection, but it is definitely a value on which future conservation can be based. Conservation scientists are making use of cultural practices in helping people to understand the importance of nature. Sea turtles are a threatened species. Scientists have been telling people about how culture has considered turtle as an important species. This helps in the local conservation efforts. Bishnoi is a religious group in Rajasthan. Bishnois believed in protecting nature and they maintained trees and animals around their areas. Chinkara was a sacred species for Bishnois. In this community was born a woman who performed the first Chipko Andolan to protect trees. In 1998, Salman Khan, a film actor, and some others were caught poaching in the Bishnoi area. The Bishnois followed this up because they believed that it was their sacred duty to protect the animals. In the end, the actor was acquitted by the court after 18 years. This case of Chinkara hunting just highlights one problem of what is faced by the traditional practices today. Traditional practices may not always be backed up by laws and policies. We have policies and laws which are actually protecting the biodiversity. But culture can always help in this. Local belief systems can be changed very soon. Along with culture, we can also add ecological significance in our awareness campaign. If you take a look around you, you might find similar practices that protect areas or protect species. In this module, we have looked at some of the conservation practices in India. These are local or cultural conservation practices. They address species and habitat protection. You can read more about this in our e-text. You can also take a look at the essential reading section and see the books and papers which document cultural conservation practices. I hope you have enjoyed this module. Thank you.